We're gonna give it a couple more minutes yet. There's a few people coming in yet, so. I didn't lose it.
Do you have your remote for your DVD player? You need
that No.
One card is kind of carrying.
You might want to start it from the beginning because I got a minute into it.
I'm just too hot. I just couldn't.
LCD player.
Can you?
It's at 1 minute and 33 seconds.
Okay, we take it out and put it back in again, and it'll. Let's see.
That one.
No.
Did I put the right one in?
Just not at the beginning. I don't know how it didn't go to the beginning. No.
Page. All right, good evening, everybody. I'd like to welcome you to the Police Standards and Training Council. I want to thank the folks here at the Police Academy for hosting us. Obviously, there's more folks here than I could accommodate at New Hampshire Fishing Game. My name is Mark Cochane, and I work here at New Hampshire Fishing Game as the Advertising and Promotions Coordinator. We develop these evening talks to kind of say thank you to all of you that have been with us, and a welcome to all of you who are new to angling and come back on to fishing. Just a couple little house cleaning things tonight. Restrooms are over here. Take note of your closest exit, just in case. There is an AED machine out front in the hallway. If somebody needs it, nobody's gonna need it. If the lights go out, if you have a power outage, it's about 60 seconds, things come back up, so just stay in your seats. Other than that, you know, sit back, relax, enjoy yourself. You're gonna get a lot of information tonight coming at you really quick. This is really good, fun seminar. And I want to introduce you to a good friend of mine who hails from Minnesota. This is his sixth year coming out to New Hampshire to come fishing and to spread the gospel, as I put it. Mr. Dave Gens.
Thank you, Mark. You certainly do have some, you know, some wonderful fishing out here. It's been a real treat to get to New Hampshire. It was, you know, my first adventures to the North Country here, the East Country, was to go up to Canada, up to Toronto, and because we thought that's where the fishermen were. But it took years to figure out that this is where the best fishing is right here in New Hampshire. You know, Vermont. And I haven't even got to Maine yet. I'm guessing there must be a fish or two in that state too. We'll go over that way. The ice fishing is, let's see what happens. I hit the play here. It said it was going to start right up like that. There we go. It is going to go that way. It's really changed a lot over the years. Now, I've been, doing this full time for the last 25 years. And it was a time before that I had a job and was, trying to get on the road to do this. It's kind of amazing how it's just getting to the Northeast up here. We've been doing this, I said, for 25 years or more, where most of us have been using electronics. But most fads start on the East Coast or the West Coast, and it takes 20 years before they get to the Midwest. And this one has kind of been reversed. It started in the Midwest, and it's taken a long time. When I get done with this adventure, I'm going to Colorado and Wyoming and Montana because they're still not fishing this way. One question I'd like to ask is, how many people in here are using some form of electronics ice fishing, a Vexilar or Mark's counting hands. That was my guess, so that's pretty good. 2 years ago when I gave this seminar, there was one, so I'm sure there's a few that bought them in the last few years, and I got a feeling that if somebody's already had them and are just coming to get some more information. But so we'll get this thing started here. Somebody's gonna turn the volume down, I'm sure. Well, we really have came a long ways from ice fishing, from the Stone Age, I guess, is how kind of what I call it, because ice fishing kind of stayed where it was for, a lot of people are still fishing the ways their grandfathers taught them, but in the last 20 years, we've kind of advanced from the Stone Age to the Space Age, meaning we use the Space Age materials that are available to us, like the graphites and the Gore-Texes and the electronics, and we've put it into ice fishing, and we've became a lot better at it. The winter fishing system is something that we've put together. There's still a great deal of information that can be got at the local bait stores. I mean, that's where the people that are fishing all the time, that are going out, getting their bait to go fishing with. I go to a lot of different shops, and I've discovered that asking, walking with your hands in your pocket and saying where they bite and is not going to get you a lot of information. Go there and buy something. If it happened to be beverages, the guy in there is going to help you out a lot more if you're spending some money in his shop. Or I've also discovered just to hang out there for a while in the morning, and see these customers coming through, and listen to them when they talk to one another, and you'll get a lot more information that way than you will, you know. Also, the internet obviously is a place to get information too, but you can't believe everything you read on there. I'm sure you've all encountered but you know, some of the methods, these lake maps that we have out there, it's amazing how ice fishermen tend not to have a lake map with them, or summer anglers usually got something that tells you how deep the water is out there, and an ice angler will tend to be followers. There's a track going out there, we'll see where that track goes, or you're walking across the ice and you see some holes that somebody else drilled, you have this terrible urge that you should drill them, fish by them spots. Fish location in the wintertime, this lake is actually overstructured and would be relatively hard to fish, but the spots I look for in the wintertime when I'm out there fishing is my favorite spot is a depression. Anytime you get a little deeper water, you got a big flat area here, and here's this little deeper water. I'm gonna go check that deeper water out. It might be the only deep spot in the entire lake, but that's where I'm gonna go. Another key area is it narrows. Anytime it narrows down, here's an example. It could be, Long Lake could be the name of the lake, and it's got a narrow spot and a little deeper water runs through there. I would, I'd go check that out. But another example is, here's a big flat. Here's a bar coming out here. Here's another flat. Here's a narrows area right in here. Anytime you encounter a narrows area, there you can bet there's going to be fish around that area, moving through that area. You get a little current going through them areas, so the zooplankton comes through there, the phytoplankton is through there, all part of the food chain. Another key area is an inside turn, or something we call it a hook. Here's an example here of one where the shallow water here, and here this deeper water dips into there. And fish will, during the daytime hours, a lot of time will spend their time in these areas here. They'll feed up in these flat areas, but in the daytime hours, it all starts that they hide in there. The panfish are hiding in there. The perch are hiding in there. So where are the bigger fish going to be? They're going to be where the other fish are hiding. So, okay, there's right here would be an inside corner. This would be an inside corner here. If I was going to fish in this particular spot, this hole here, this is really a good area right here. On this end, this happened to be a lake that I rented fish houses out in my younger days. So I'm extra familiar with this lake and the spots that we've caught fish in. Kind of an interesting thing about this lake. Look at this little depression right here. And I went there quite a few times in my life, and I can't catch any fish in that spot in the wintertime. It's a great spot in the springtime. It took me a long time to understand why. This happens to be the south end of the lake, north is up here. And most of our fishing spots, our good fishing spots, are on the north end of these lakes. And if you start thinking about it, I bet you're gonna agree with me. What happens when these lakes freeze up, usually the wind is out of the northwest. That's when the cold weather comes. And it might be northeast here too, you get some of the cold weather, but I'm still guessing most of the time it's northwest, like it is back in Minnesota where I'm from. And the northwest wind blows, starts cooling that surface water down, and the wind blows it to the south end of the lake. And just before freeze up, the cold water is all pushed down here. Water's as cold as it's heaviest at 39 degrees, and it sinks to the bottom, and the lighter water's on the top. And but when the wind keeps blowing that surface water down here, this area right here would fill up with this cold water. This would be 34, 35 degree water. And the fish they're just not active in there. They actually go dormant. So the north end of the lake is where the 39 degree water is more abundant. And I used to think the north end of the lakes were always good because the snow wasn't as deep there and we could access it. The south end of the lake, the wind, snow blows down there, but I've discovered that temperature has got a lot to do with it. Another thing I've learned is that aerated lakes, where the aerators run, that turns up that water, and you don't find 39 degree water on the bottom because the aerator's been bubbling all the time and makes that water turn over. And I've caught a lot of fish in aerated lakes, but then once they turn them aerators on, then it's like you can't catch them anymore. And I
you know, obviously I went and fished by the aerator. You think that it's got to be oxygen, but I discovered it's temperature. So that's kind of what happened with some of our cameras. Now we've got a temperature gauge on there, and that's what really got me to understand that when I started, you know, monitoring the temperature in the water. Well, now I've got to get back to this, these spots here. You know, here's another one of the narrowest areas here. Here's a bar out in the middle of the lake. Here's another bar here, you know, and narrows through there. Okay, another key spot are weed beds. So if I've never been to a lake before and I'm gonna go out there, how do I know where the weeds are in the lake? Well, when you went to that bait store that you went to, or you know, you ask somebody, or sometimes available right on the lake map, is how deep do the weeds grow? You know, and so you got a lot of clear water lakes around here. So a lot of times, let's say it's a 15 foot weed line. So what am I looking for? I'm looking for wide spots in the contour lines. You know, like here would be a example of here's a 10 foot contour line. Here's the 15 foot contour line. You could bet there's a weed bed right in here. You know, there wouldn't be much for weeds here where the lines are real close together. You know, over here, some more examples where the weed lines, wide spots in the contour lines is where you find the weed beds. You know, sometimes it could be there'll be a bay. You know, this isn't a very good example here, but at the mouth of a bay, you'll have that 15 foot in there, or the 10 to 15 foot where there'll be weeds. But that's what you're looking for, is wide spots in the contour lines, and you can bet that's where the weeds are going to grow. Another key spot is the base of a break. Now this would be a good walleye perch spot. And let's just use this for example, 30 foot of water, that's the basin. I want to know where 27, 28, 29 is, right where that starts to break up. That's a real good spot for the perch to hang out. What happens in there, the burrowing insects, the mayfly larvae that are in the lake, they have a hard time out in the basin because it's too muddy. They can't get down in there and burrow them holes in there. Some of these mayflies actually live in the bottom for 2 years before they hatch and fly away. When we see them, they live in the bottom. And it's at the base of these breaks is where they can burrow these, make their little bug beds, as we call them. So if you're out there and it's, you know, could be 40 foot, could be 25 foot flat, you want to go to where it starts breaking up. And that's where a lot of times you'll find them fish. You know, so, you know, example, like at the base of this break here, you know, there wouldn't be any weeds along here, but right at the base of the break is where you could have some fish. So let's... You know, a lot of times you go out there and you'll see a bunch of people that are out there fishing. You know, it's the middle of the day. So you go out there and, you know, I'm gonna go check it out, you know, and you got people out there must be something going on, but stop and observe a little bit. If the people are fishing, you know, I'm gonna go over there too. But if they're throwing a football around or barbecuing, you know, I'm not gonna go fishing, you know, drill some holes by them. You know, you look at your lake map and you can pick an area like it, or you can come and you know, you pick areas amongst or around the people where there isn't anybody. Like here's an area here, a lot of people in here. They'll push them fish into these areas where there isn't anybody. You know, so that you know, drill some holes there, you could find some fish. Or off to the side, you might see a few people. You know, if you see a few guys sitting off to the side and they got some blue fish traps sitting over there and they're not moving around much, you can bet they're on some fish. You know, and the because they wouldn't be sitting there if they weren't on them fish, especially if they're fishing in one person shelters. You know, that's what myself and all my friends are fishing out of. We're fishing out of one person shelters. We don't fish alone, we fish independently. You know, we all got this gear that we're talking about here. We all got electronics, we all got an auger, you know, we all got rods and reels, we all got a GPS, you know, and you know, we go out there and generally we can find some fish and catch them. Uh-oh, come on, there we go. You know, then, like I said, we looked at our map and we got away from the crowd. We took off, walked off, and found another inside corner. And something real satisfying for me to go to a lake that I'd never been to before and go out there and catch something. You often get asked, what's my favorite fish to catch? Well, it's red lines on my Vexilar. I don't care what's down there. I just want to go out and catch something. You know, and generally, if you're, you know, if you're catching fish, you catch all different species. If they're down there, we're going to figure out how to catch them. You know, it takes a, you know, you got to drill holes when you're out there if you want to catch more fish. You know, I probably drilled a lot more erratic and holes when I was younger. Now that I'm older, I drill a few holes at a time. You know, I drill 4, 5, 6 holes, and then fish them holes. Now, if there's a few of us fishing together, and we all do that, you know, these holes build up pretty fast. So we're trolling is what we're doing. We're doing the same thing we do in the summertime. We're working down a break line. We're working in this corner. We're covering this flat. We're, you know, over this depression. And it's amazing how quickly that we find some fish. And, you know, and auger technology is really moving on right now. You know, I've been talking about it for a few years. People ask me, what do I see, what's new in the future? And I've been saying we're going to be drilling holes with electric augers here now. You know, and there's been some real advancements this year where, you know, the Ion is one that that came out this year with electric auger. Just before this trip started here, I didn't even have this before this trip. You know, Vexilar, the same people that make the electronics are now in the auger business. You know, 10-pound auger. It's just amazing how light and easy it is to drill holes. You see what it's going to drill with a Milwaukee bit on it. I mean, I said that. I didn't have this until just before I left to come on this trip. And I don't know, I'm guessing we drilled close to 60 holes today with that auger on one battery. And it's, you know, it's amazing what's happening with batteries. So, you know, it's time to trade in them 3-horse augers that we've got in and get something that's a lot lighter so it's easier to drill them holes. If it's easy, you'll do it. If it's not easy, you won't. And that's pretty much anything we do. We need to, you know, make things easy. You know, and then to fish all them holes. I mean, we even probably did a little bit of that today. We, you know, didn't get all the holes fished in that we drilled. But, you know, I see guys go out, they get to the lake and they go out and they drill a bunch of holes and where they don't really need them and they don't fish them. It doesn't make any sense if you're not going to fish them to drill these holes. So, you know, think about that. You know, you drill 3-4 at a time, you fish them, and then you figure out we're going to drill the next 3 or 4. You know, when the ice gets real thick, you know, up to this point, we've been still using gas augers. I think that's coming to a rapid change here. You know, getting the power augers in the thick ice, you know, we got mounts for them. So here's a little trick that I use. You'll see we're going to drill right through here. And we're going to watch my foot right here, what's going to happen after the auger goes through. If you kick that snow away like that before you pull the auger out, I don't have to skim that hole now. I don't have to carry a skimmer with me. I can fish that hole right now. That is such a key factor to not just pick the auger out and let all that slush in, and then you got to go skim it out. In fact, I want a little slush left in that hole, especially if I'm fishing shallower water. I've seen it so many times that if you're fishing in the weed beds in shallower water, and if you skim all that slush out of that hole, it's hard to catch a fish in that hole because you got this column of light that's going down that hole. And if the fish are at all finicky, they stay away from them spots. You know, as late ice comes and we start fishing shallower and shallower, you know, on a day that is warm, you know, if it's, you know, below zero, you're out there fishing, you got to skim it out because it's going to freeze, you can't get your line down it. You know, but on a nice day where it's above freezing, a couple ways I'll get my line down. One, I'll just take the rod tip, put it in the hole, and give it a little twirl and make a tiny little hole. I'll get my lure down there. Or another way that I'll do it is I'll take the lure and wind it up to the end of the rod and then stick the rod through the slush and then open the bail. And then the lure falls down. So a couple ways you can get your line down through these slushy holes. And you'd be amazed how many more fish you can catch in a hole that has. You know, and here we talk about the electric drills again. You'll see how quickly these things go through the ice. So we use this one today, last couple days, and it's you know, it's easy. Again, if it's easy, you'll drill these holes. Now, these happen to only be a 6-inch auger. You know, if you're lake trout fishing, you might want a bigger one, but you know, they're starting to make some good 8-inch. Now look how quickly that would go through this early ice, you know, with just so little effort. But when the ice gets thick, then it's, you know, when you start getting down there, now it starts working on the battery, starts draining the battery through this thick ice. But you'll see it still drills through the thick ice, but it takes a lot more battery to drill through a hole through that much ice. So again, start thinking about it. They make a little attachments. If you've got a good cordless drill at home, a good one, meaning that they need to have steel gears in them is what they need to have. Some of the less expensive ones that you'd buy at a Walmart, you know, for $69, $79, they're not going to have steel gears in it. They're not going to drill these holes with these augers. But if you went to the Home Depot and bought a good drill for, you know, $200 or more, they'll have steel gears in them. And then you can just buy a hand auger from the, you know, from the store. They make little adapters that'll go from the drill to the hand auger. And, you know, you're set. You're out there drilling these holes. I just plain won't go fishing without my Vexilar. I see these people put up their hands, the 16 of them. Wouldn't you all agree with me that once you have that, you're not going to go without it? You know, it's, you know, we tell people all the time that, you know, you can double your ice fishing catch if you get one of these. You know, it's pretty hard for anyone that's never had or never used one. I think you're going to double your catch. We've all been sold something like that over television. That, you know, I get several things at home that they swore that I was going to catch more if I used this, and they're still in the old tackle box or in the garage, laying on the floor or wherever they may be. But this is one thing that will, I mean, you just learn so much. It's a mood indicator. It tells you how the fish are reacting to your bait. As soon as you put it in the hole, it instantly tells you if there's weeds or other cover down there. It's you know, you see how the fish are reacting to your bait. You know how deep the water is. It's just got so much information, and it's instant. You know, if you didn't ever see one in operation and you had a camera you were going to get, or a flasher, you would, you know, in your mind you would think, well, a camera is so much better, I'm going to be able to see. But it takes so long to get it set up. To me, a camera is a toy, and the Vexilar is a tool. And once you start using a flasher ice fishing, you will double your ice fishing catch. And wouldn't most of you agree that that's what's happened since you've used one, is that you catch twice as many fish as you did before? I see, you know, heads being nodded. That, and it's amazing how the price of them really hasn't changed that much from the, you know, the first ones that we had, you know, back in the 80s is when we really started using these things a lot. You know, they were, $200 was probably the least that you could get one for. One of these three colors, that's what they kind of cost, and they're still under $300 for the least expensive one. And this one works just as well. You'll get more bells and whistles on the newer versions of them, but as far as does it work, they work just fine. And again, I just won't go fishing without it. It's, you know, we've got some up here. If you got questions on how they work, we can demonstrate that at the end here.
Oh, it's here in my FL22. I don't have that.
So this is kind of, you know, for the people that already have one, that we're going to talk a little bit about that float that's floating your transducer around. I don't use one of them floats, and you'll see why here.
On there, I have an eye bolt that I screwed right into the box, and every time you buy a Vexilar, it comes with this eye bolt, and I didn't put the float on because. Not only does the float suspend the transducer, it actually keeps the transducer from touching the side of the ice. And what I did to compensate for that is I just took a piece of the float and put it on the transducer. Now this happens to be a big transducer here. I actually made the foam a little bit bigger so that the foam is bigger than the transducer. And now the foam hits against the side of the ice and allows the transducer to hang straight. And I don't have a lot of cord out. It's a lot easier to move from hole to hole when you've got just a short piece of cord out so I could pick it up, walk to the next hole. I'm not carrying this thing up over my head. I keep my arm at rest on the way down there. We can just put that right in the hole. Now, I like to keep the transducer more out in the center of the hole. You get a much better, you know, clearer picture that's down there. But sometimes, for whatever reason, you can't, and the box sits back there. Because of that piece of foam I have on there, that's what allowed me to push that back and let the cord touch the side of the hole. Without that foam on there, my transducer would now not be hanging straight, and I wouldn't be able to see my jig. But it's much easier to not have all that cord hanging down there. And there was a fish down there. There's a perch. Yeah, a perch, but it looks like it's one that would be tasty.
Well, we kind of talked about underwater cameras there a little bit that I'm... But what I do with them is I downview. Downviewing mean is I put it in the little hook right there and look straight down. To put a camera down, I guess my most favorite thing to say, I guess, if I'm going to go out there on the lake and have my portable fish house there, or I'm fishing outside, I drill two holes and I put the camera down one hole, my line down the other, and now I spend time trying to get to see my lure. You know, I got the camera over here, and here's my lure, and the camera's over here. And then finally, I get it to come over here. There it is. Oh, it just took some time to get it at the right level, and then the camera drifted over this way. But now I finally get it lined up, and there's been some time involved here. It didn't just happen right away. But now there's no fish there. You know, but here's my jig going up and down. You know, and I always say, how long does it take to catch nothing? You know, but you'll sit there now and watch that jig go up and down because you got the camera lined up. Now, if you got, you know, you got a big bob house that you're out there and you're gonna spend some time in there, it kind of makes sense to have a camera then to look at the your lines that are down there. You know, back in Minnesota, they have a lot of wheeled fish houses, which means they pull them behind their trucks, they drive out on the ice, and they got different methods. Some of them are hydraulic even, and they lower right down onto the ice, and they go. It's winter camping is what it really is. They go out there, they leave the city. You know, it would be like leaving Boston and, you know, driving up here, up to Winnipesaukee, and they drive it on the lake, and that's where they spend the weekend. They get up there, they go up Friday night, and they're, you know, they got beds in them, TVs in them, kitchens in them, you know, bathrooms in them, and that's where they spend the weekend. They spend Friday night there all day Saturday, you know, Saturday night. Some of them have TVs in them, so they even watch the football game there on Sunday, and then they pack up and they go back home again. Makes sense for them people to have a camera. But if you're out just moving around, you really want to have a flasher to help to help catch them fish.
I'm fishing with the new Vexlar Double Vision.
So we'll talk about them here a little bit.
Package both the camera and the flasher into the same package. It really help you learn how to read your flasher, and you'll see them on the flasher up here. This is my jig going up and down right there on the flasher, and there's my jig moving on the camera right there. You know, what a nice combo to have the flasher and.
But I'm down viewing now.
We'll
talk about that a little bit.
So if I'm just out searching from hole to hole in deeper water, I can just use the Vexlar. If I'm searching from hole to hole in the weeds, I can use the camera. Or, you know, if I'm struggling catching them, I can watch the fish bite. And just a great cameras. It's kind of a dark, dreary day today, so the camera's working in black and white today. You don't need as much light then. But if it was a bright sunny day, then it's in full color. The weeds are nice and green. You can see the color of your lure. I'll be caught in that cord. Wrapped around it. No, he didn't. That's a beauty. He just come right in and ate it too. He didn't, wasn't no time to take pictures of him. I've seen him eat it.
You know, but you know, as I talked about downswing, we're putting that thing right in the hole that I'm fishing out of, because then it's quick and instant. I drop that in and I see it sinking down on the on my Vexilar, so I know when to stop it. I'll stop it 2, 3, 4 feet above my lure, depends upon the water quality, and I see my jig right away. I'm not spending this time moving it back and forth trying to, you know, find my lure, and it makes the camera a much more usable tool. Well, now we gotta, you know, we gotta catch him. We've kinda...
Right, a hook of him, it's really important to get it right. There's a pointed end on him and a flat end on him. You get the flat up between your fingers, the flat end, and you give it a little squeeze, and it bulges up on the end right there. Now, I wanna hook that little bulge, but if I hook him like this, I tend to hook him too deep and pop him and let the innards out. So I get it between my fingers, and I wanna actually pull up on it. So I'm going to hook him in here, I'm going to pull up on it. I just barely hook him on the end there. You know, I always like to mix up the colors. See, I hook it, push it in there, pull up on it. You just catch that little bulge on the end. Do it again there. Put the hook up against my finger, catch it, pull up through there. And I like to get, you know, 3, 4 of them on there. You know, sometimes they're finicky, they want a smaller bait, but this is number 10 hook here. You know, I get put a few of them on there, and in that bump there, it's called their scent sac. It's a clear liquid that comes out of them right on my finger there. It's not yellow or white or orange red juice, it's clear. That's the natural fish attractor that's in them. So another key factor, you know, after you catch a fish, the bait tends to hang like this. And this is a horizontal bait, so I have to take the knot and slide it around the eye of the hook so that it hangs horizontal. And then that little pounding motion works and makes that bait kick. I'll put it in the hole here, and you can see how this looks just right up here. You just get that bait going in the hole like that. Even though you're shaking it quite a bit, it's not much there. Or here, I'll just tap the rod tip. See how you get it? You move it around a little bit. You know, and the thing is, every time that bait jumps in the water, I can actually feel that on my rod tip. You know, and when I don't feel that thing bouncing, that's when I know I got a bite. But you see how that looks in the water there? You know, no. You know, a lot of people tend to make these big jigs like that. I think it looks more inviting to make them little jigs and then move it up and down than it does to make, you know, longer jigs. So one of the things that can really help you become a better winter angler is learning the pound, as we call it. Just,
you know, we've kind of changed this year. You know, we've been talking about pounding them baits for a long time, and you know, it just wasn't catching on. And this year, in the article that I wrote, we talked about cadence. And it seems like cadence is a word that we more understand, rhythm and cadence. And the change the rhythm can, you know, trigger these fish into biting and change the cadence in what you're doing. Kind of an example of that is crankbaits. You know, if you're fishing in the summertime and you're fishing with one style of bait and you're not doing very well, you'll change to another one. And it moves different in the water. Spinner blades would be another one where you fished a smaller blade. It's got a different cadence, different rhythm than what a bigger one does. You know, it's got to feel good to the fish too. It's not only that it has to look good, taste good, but that lateral line that's on the side of these fish, it has to feel good to them. And that's what we're doing when we're working these baits. You know, we see these fish on our flashers, and what we were doing is not working, you know, so we can change the rhythm at that time. That's another reason they're so important, because you can try these experiments when there's fish there. Excuse me. There's, you know, so many little things that make a difference. You know, it seems like fishermen are out looking for a magic lure. You know, what's magic out there? It's all these little bitty things that are put together that you know, trigger them fish into biting. You know, if there's anything, any magic out there, it's in the electronics. Excuse me, I'm going to have to grab a drink of water over here. I got this tickle. except I don't know where it went. There it is. I think I noticed, you noticed the slush in the hole that I didn't, I don't have that hole skimmed all out. I just seldom skim them holes out. It makes a difference if you're fishing in, shallower water.
Plastics are becoming a bigger and bigger part of ice fishing all the time. We've just learned over time that these panfish especially will eat just a piece of plastic. And I guess we already knew that. I've spent a lot of time going lake trout fishing for real big fish with plastic too. Northerns, I've caught muskies on plastic, and now we're doing it with the panfish. I've kind of discovered the ones that come to a point on the end seem to work the best for me. And when you rig them, you just start it in there on the blunt end and light it around just like you're putting on a piece of plastic in the summertime. And you get it so that it's nice and straight on your hook. Like I pushed it out a little bit too far, so I'm going to back it up a little bit. So you get that thing nice and straight on there. And that little piece of plastic, if it comes to a point, you can't hardly stop it from jigging. So we'll just put that in the hole here. And you'll see that the end of that thing is
kind of hard to see it, but
on there all the time. It doesn't take much. You can work it like that. You just get that little tail moving in there. And then fish really like that. So again, plastics and for ice fishing are a great way to catch some fish.
Becoming more and more, popular all the time. I'm, learning plastics by itself. I learned stuff here when I got to Vermont. With my fishing partner over there, Jamie, that I fish with, he designed one piece of plastic called a Jamie lure. And, the difference, what I was doing wrong with it, he was catching all these fish on it, and I've been struggling, is that he didn't push it on the hook all the way. When we put on plastics, I just talked about how to get it straight on there. Well, he only pushed it, partially around the shank of his hook, so that the plastic tail, now he's a horizontal bait or a 45 degree angle bait, and he had the plastic tail sticking straight up in the air. I'm just in awe how many fish I've caught on that since I've been over here the last, 3-4 days of fishing that it works. So simple little things, adjusting these plastic, all these different creatures. Scott Mackey from Mackey Plastics out of New York makes the plastics that we've been using. And there's lots of different kinds out there, but Scott does a really good job. They're nice and soft. They got some flavor to them. Some other ones that have worked over time are the noogies, which are just almost like a round ball, like a salmon egg with a tail on the end of it. That's another one that works, but it still seems like the ones that work the best have a point to the end of the tail. And when you hold that in the water, you'll note that you can't hardly stop that tail from having action. So it's, don't be afraid to experiment with plastics. This is kind of interesting. This was a few years back. We were up on Mille Lacs Lake in Minnesota catching a lot of real nice perch. And this is what we were fishing with. And this is what they were spitting up in the bucket after we caught them. So you can certainly see why them perch were eating that piece of plastic there. That's an adult mayfly larva there. That's, again, that lives down in the bottom. these were adult there now. They're going to hatch this summer. But they start coming out and they start swimming around. They need more food, so they actually come out and start swimming around late in the season and start feeding on zooplankton. And these were apparently out in the daytime where these perch were grubbing them out. I've seen these bug beds on this particular lake where you go down there and the bottom of the lake is just full of these little bitty holes. You wonder what in the heck could be making all these little holes in the bottom. But these are the things that'll do that. They said they lived in them little holes for 2 years. They come out in that golden hour in the evening when the sun is going down, they stick their little head out of the hole and they start feeding on the zooplankton that's moving around. And that's how they survive. When they come out of them holes would swim around, and then the fish would get them. So there's now here are some of the different, you know, styles. This was the Jamie that I was fishing with here recently with the twin tails. Here's another one up here. These all come to point on the end. I don't have that great of luck with these other models. You know, maybe somebody else has a different experience. You know, I would think this one I could catch some fish on. I haven't used it yet. I think there might even be some more in the next.
When you're using a larger size hook, sometimes the bait and it gets hard to put on. So a simple way to cure that is to take a pair of pliers like this and just put it right on the barb and give it a little pinch. You pinch that barb down. Now it'll slide on a lot easier, and the barb won't tear up the bait. You know.
Back to talking about fishing with that larva. We've got some up here, so if you're interested, we can show you how to do it after the presentation here.
Really well onto the hook, and if you don't keep it fresh, it's like fishing with dead minnows. You know, you don't hesitate when you catch a fish on a minnow. You're in the bucket to get a new minnow. But when you catch a fish on the worm type baits, we sometimes tend to reposition it.
But a simple little thing like pinching that barb down, and you're not going to lose them fish, especially if you got a decent rod. Rods have really came a long ways too. That manufacturers now are building rods. They're 6-foot rods built in miniature. You know, they're not a broken rod blank anymore or a stick with a eye bolt tied to the end of it. You know, they're actually building rods for the ice angler. And your ice rods are really inexpensive if you think about them. I'm sure a lot of you in here that have got a summer fishing rod that costs $100 or more. An ice rod has got a nice cork handle on it. It's got 3 or 4 guides on it, and it's got the tip on it. So your summer rod is about all it really has is a lot more shaft between the cork and the first guide. You know, so think about that. They cost $100, and an ice rod costs $30 or $40 for a real good ice rod. So the value is really in them ice rods. A good ice rod. Here's something that's helped me catch more fish by, letting the bobber go down. You know, if you're bobber fishing and you didn't catch it, you missed them, what do you do next time? You let the bobber go down farther. When we're jink fishing, we tend not to, we set the hook right away as soon as we feel something. So you see what I did there is I let the bobber go down. We'll talk about that here.
The thing about tight lining sometimes is that you get a bite and you miss them. And you miss them a couple times. Well, back when I used to fish with a bobber, what a person would do is he'd let the bobber go down farther. You know, sometimes he'd let the bobber go all the way down to the bottom of the ice. So what I do now when I'm tight lining is if I feel that bite and I missed them, and it's like there's one there, then you just drop the rod tip, let the line go flat. That's the same thing as letting the bobber go down. Sometimes the line will tighten up and then you pull, or you'll count. You'll go 1, 2, and then you'll set the hook and try to hook the fish. You know, if it didn't work after 2, you try a 3 count. So just think about it as let the bobber go down, because that's what we did back in our bobber days. But now with these good sensitive graphite rods, light line that hangs nice and straight, jig, you can actually feel them working down there. There's really no need to have that bobber on our line. So next time you've missed a couple tight lining, just drop that rod tip. That's the same as letting the bobber go down. Let the bobber go down a little bit there.
You know, it's also forgot what I was going to say. How's that? We'll go back.
Come on up here. Yeah, bluegill. Get back down there because there's another one. Nope, lost him. Should have let the bobber go down a little bit. I'm going to do that this time. I won't take him right away this time. Now watch this here now. When he comes up and hits it, there he's got it. See the line slack? I'm letting it eat it. And then I got him.
Well, as I was going to do, when you're sight fishing, that you tend to do that. If you're looking down the hole watching, you know, as that fish comes in and he grabs it, if he doesn't have it, we drop the rod tip down and we let him swim off until he swallows it. And you'd see that fish that we just looked at there. If I would have set the hook right away, he didn't have the hook in his mouth. He just had the bait in his mouth. And that's why sometimes we got to let the bobber go down.
Dandy bluegill. Can I get the?
Sometimes it's about speed fishing too. When they're down there, you got to get back there down there as quick as you can.
Oh, I'm gonna get one. The one come in. Come on. Here he comes. There, hit it. Give him a little time. Take him.
I wish they always bit as good as them do. They need to slide here. Uh-oh.
Let him eat it a little bit. Take him. All right. See, that's just dropping that rod tip down. Give him a little time. It's something you got to practice. Something that's hard not to set the hook. It's a reflex thing. Oh, I hate to take the time to put the bait on.
Well, that's something that I tend to do is I ask myself why I caught them fish. You know, there seems to be a reason why this hole was better than the other hole. Is it a little bit deeper here? Is it a little bit shallower here? Did they want the bait rising? Did they want it falling? Just don't accept that I caught these fish. So many times there'll be, you know, somebody, two people fishing together and they'll claim that we're doing exactly the same thing and he's catching all the fish. You know, that it's not exactly the same thing, or you'd both be catching fish. You know, back to that rhythm thing, the cadence is a little bit different. You know, there's a lot of little things that, so, you know, keep asking yourself them questions. Why are the fish over there? There's a reason. And if you keep asking yourself why, you will, you know, come up with more answers. And something I've been poor at, some of you younger people in the audience here, is keeping a log. I tried it a few times through my life, and I'm not, I'm just not good at it. You know, I tried dieting. You're supposed to write your food down, you eat. I'm not good at that neither. You know, but if you can, you know, write that down when you got home that day. You know, why did the fish bite today? What's the weather conditions? Was it rainy? Was it cloudy? Was it clear? What did the barometer do? There's all these things. What was the moon phase? You know that, and you will become a better angler as time goes on, and you get something to look, you know, to look back at. Here's one of my favorite positions at the fish shop. It's right off my snowmobile. And it's got to be easy.
One of my favorite ways to fish is just sitting around in the snowmobile seat. Very comfortable, easy to move from spot to spot. And if I pull up the hole, drop the transducer in the hole, grab my lure. In this case, I'm going to put some bait on it. Get it baited up here so it looks good. Always important to keep fresh bait on there. It's always aggravating me if I don't have fresh bait on there and that fish comes in and don't bite. I know that's why. It's that the juice has gone off of that bait. Well, there we got some fresh stuff. And you can see how easy it is. Dropping right down onto these fish. You know, it's pretty easy going out here now. There's not a lot of snow, but early in the year when the snow was real deep, it was really nice to fish off the machine like this. You just drill it, you know, one hole at a time, then you're not trudging around in that snow. And just a lot of work, but if you're pulling your fish house and, you know, sitting on here, you kind of get your back to the wind or even the front to the windshield kind of helps get the wind over the top of you. Wouldn't be a hanky, keeps the wind off your line, so it's easy to detect the bites. One of my favorite ways to fish is, you know, when I'm searching for fish. You know, obviously when I find them and I know I'm in the right area, then I can, you know, get the fish trap out and fish in the house. And you can see how quick and easy it is for me to move.
So it, you know, so it is easy. If it's easy, again, you'll do it. It will cover a lot of ground. You know, a couple of my friends got exactly the same rigs. We get to a lake, you know, we start leapfrogging over one another, and it's amazing how quickly we can locate fish, and you know, once we find them, it's not that hard to catch them. It's finding them is the tricky part. You know, our clothing has got a whole lot better over the last few years too. This. Ice armor clothing. Well, the you know, I wore from Carhartts to, I think the last, my wife made a nice suit for me when I first started doing it. It was a bright blue suit that I had that I wanted people to see me when I was out there walking from person to person, showing them how this fish trap worked and how the electronics worked. And but I always had wet knees, and because I would kneel down on the ice, and I always had a wet butt because I'd sit back on my heels. You know, I'd carry a piece of styrofoam or a board to kneel on, but you'd still end up getting wet. I'm sure some of you are still doing that. Then the first Gore-Tex suit that came along was actually a Fenwick suit, and it was marketed as rain gear. And I actually bought one of them, and I believe I paid $279 for it, and this would have been, you know, 30 years ago, 25 years ago anyway. Well, more like 30 years ago, which was a lot of money. But once I put that suit on and went out there and discovered I didn't get wet anymore when I kneeled down on the ice or sat on things, that was, it was amazing. That's what I wore. In 2006, the patent ran out on the Gore-Tex, so that's why now you see all these other clothing out there. And at Clam, we started making ice armor at that time. Stearns actually made the first stuff for us. And what I knew what we needed was we needed to pad the knees, because an ice anglers always end up kneeling down. If you're tip-up fishing, or if you're pan fishing, walleye fishing, lake trout fishing, it doesn't make any difference. It seems like you want to kneel down by the hole and end up sitting on cold things. So we padded the seat and made a cushion on there. Now we've got three versions. We got the blue suit, which now we've changed the name to it. We call it the Edge. We have the gray suit, which is considerably warmer, which is called the Extreme, and now we have the new Ultra suit this year that I started wearing it in the boat last fall, and I just could not believe how warm it was. I mean, that's when I get the coldest. I think you probably agree with me that them last days in the boat in the fall seemed like you can't already stay warm, and I stayed totally warm in that Ultra suit. And then we had a gal out yesterday that was new to ice fishing and never ice fished before. I seen the clothing that she had brought along, and I knew she would freeze to death if we didn't, and we put this Ultra suit on her, and the only thing that got cold on her was her feet and her hands, because it wasn't in the, she wasn't in that suit, but she survived the whole day out on the ice with us and caught her first fish through the ice. It was kind of fun to be out with someone that had never caught a fish through the ice before, and to see her catch her first fish. It was just a small perch, actually, but she was still extremely excited for her first fish. And of course, before the day was over, she ended up catching the biggest crappie of the day at a 12-incher, and And, you know, she had a great time. She caught, you know, several different kinds of fish, and we kept her warm because we dressed her properly. You know, you need to, you know, protect from the wind. So if, you know, if you're thinking about some new outerwear, I really highly recommend the Ice Armor clothing. We've put a lot of research in it, and they are extremely warm. You know, there's the, you know, this is the gray suit, and then we got the new Ultra suit. You know, if there's anything wrong with them suits, is they got too many pockets. You know, you're constantly trying to find something, but all the pockets are really nice because you got a place to keep all this stuff. But it's amazing, the phone starts ringing and you're trying to figure out which pocket the phone is in, or, you know, you can't find your bait, or it's, but it's, they, we, you know, do a great job of keeping the ice angler warm and dry. You know, there's lots of different shelters out there. Myself, I don't fish in the cabin style. We fish in the fish trap style, which are more like winter bass boats than they are, you know, cabins that you're going to go to. Although we make lots of different versions. Now these are all the different one man versions that we make, from the Pro that Mark is sitting in over there to the Scout that Joe is sitting on to the Nanook is actually a two person. Mark has one of them too, and the Trapper is the same size as the Scout, just doesn't have a seat built in it, which makes it less expensive. You know, Dick's would be probably a place that handles our products, or either that, these smaller versions can be mail ordered in from the Midwest with you know, a lot of times no shipping because they're UPSable. And then we got the big versions, the hub style houses are becoming real popular. This is a new house for this year, they're called the six pack. It's, these panels are 6 feet around, so it's 11 and a half feet across, 36 feet around. It's a huge shelter. A lot of windows in it so that you can watch your tip ups. You know, this one's got a thermal top in it so it won't sweat on you. Something I do know that's coming out this summer that I think is really excited is we're gonna have this in a screen house. And we got to use one last summer, and it's amazing how this thing sets up quickly. You know, because it seems like in the evening when all of a sudden the evening comes and here the mosquitoes show up and you know, it doesn't last for long, and but can drive you in and kind of ruin the evening, and this thing will set up in a minute. You can have this thing set up, and it's a huge place that you can set your lawn chairs in. And we got lots of different versions of the flip over fish houses too. And ice fishing combos. It's a good quality rod is as important in the wintertime as it is in the summer to get that feel. So, you know, and stiffness equals sensitivity. You know, if the lure that you have is bending the tip of your rod, it means the feel's not there. But yet it's got to be a balance so that the rod bends. I talked to some people here about, and I'm sure that we have a tendency to think that when the rod was too soft, that we set the hook when we're ice fishing and the fish gets away. You know, I mean, how far do you have to move that line? A lot of times the fish are 30, 40 feet straight below you. You know, when in you jerk that line, if you don't have to move it that far. It's all about the rod's got to stay bent. That's what allows us to catch them fish. So, you know, to get that balance between the rod, the line, and the lure. You know, spinning lures have been a real issue for the people that want to sight fish. That's why this year we made the dip fly reels. What we did different at Clam is I wanted to put this little foot on here so it fishes more like a summertime reel. So you can grab onto it and wind it up. You don't have to, you know, it's just a lot easier to handle than the standard fly reels. So, you know, check out a good quality rod. You know, you don't want one that bends all the way down to the handle. I hear people say, oh, my rod is so sensitive. And they got one that's, you know, has no backbone whatsoever to it. You know, remember that stiffness equals sensitivity. So, you know, think about it. We got a lot of good rods up here. If you're interested in looking at some of these rods, come up and look at them here afterwards. You know, jig boxes are nice to keep all your jigs in order. When you just put them in a some kind of a cup and you carry them around in your pocket and you shake them around, pretty soon they're kind of all one color. They're all kind of gray, you know. So we got some nice jig boxes that we've designed to hold the jigs. Also, this here is to keep your plastics from rubbing together or getting together. You know, got a lot of nice lighting systems, a battery case, you know, a rod case. We got one sitting on the counter there. You know, lighting system. This has been a great light. I've had it for 4 or 5 years now. I got rid of my trouble light that I have at home. How many times have you taken your, you're going to use your trouble light to work on your truck, your lawnmower, or whatever it may be, and the first thing you do is you drop it and the bulb burns out and you're, you know, looking for a bulb. This works like, you know, it's a great trouble light. It's rechargeable, lasts for hours, works for, it's a great light in your fish house also. Well, if you're a traveling ice angler like I am, here's my rig that's sitting out in the parking lot right out here. And this is some of the things we do, that we can do. You know, it doesn't have to mean you travel all the way across the country. You could be just traveling to a new lake. But look how nice this sets right into that hitch on there. You know, that easy, and now we're out. And this is just kind of an introduction. We're going to go through all this again. You know, become a traveling ice angler. The adventure awaits. To you don't have to. You can go to another state.
See, we got lots of room in here. I built this shelf in here so you can double deck things. I got a fish house here, a fish house here. Also, one will fit in front of us, so I can actually put 4 fish traps in here. You know, here I got a couple power augers in here. You know, lots of room to put your gear. You know, this van has got a lot of room in it, a lot more than a, you know, it seems the trends are 4-door pickups right now. Seems to be the trends, but you really haven't got any haul space when you do that. Here we got lots of haul space. I pull this single place snowmobile trailer. You know, this is my bass boat on ice right here. The engine for my bass boat on ice I get. And we got these skis here. What we do with these skis is we can put them right on the wheels of the trailer. You know, get the idea here. You know, I have these made. Just an aluminum ski. A little wheel holder there. Got a square bar on the bottom of it there so that it tracks nice. The thing that we've done is we've mounted an auger rack on the front of the snowmobile. Most of the time things are on the back. I've found a lot more comfortable to put it up on the front. I can see it, I know when it's clamped in. You know, you can see we just take the auger here, you can just set it right up in the rack. And just, in this case, we just got some bungee cords that can hold the auger on there. And we're ready to move on to a fishing destination, location. You know, here's actually my fish house. We got it set inside here right now instead of on the back. And you can kind of see the way that I've got it rigged up here. Now here's my nice comfortable seat to sit on. But on the back of the seat here, I've got my tackle. All my tackle is right here in the pouch. You know, my little boxes. You know, a lot of them as I'm fishing end up in my pocket. But right now, they're stored on here. And the ones I'm using are in my, would be in my pocket. Over here, I put a rod hamper in. I place to keep all my rods. Because hammock is a good name for it. So, you know, so they're easy to get at. You know, I've got, you know, nice rod cases in here too for storing them. But you know, the ones that I'm fishing with, I want them easily accessible to me. You know, so you know, 2 or 3. You know, I got probably too many in here right now. But just a nice spot to keep the rods. You know, my electronics here stored underneath. Another thing I've got is my heater. I've got it mounted right here in the fish house. It's not just sitting back here loose. It's rigid in that place. So I put it in the half-mast position. I can run that heater while I'm out on the ice. Now, after I get the snowmobile off the trailer, we can just pick up the trailer and put the ski underneath of it there, on the tire. Obviously, one for each side. This little hitch in the backpack here. Simple little thing on the back of my Bearcat here. The trailer tongue will just snap right into there. Here is another one of my fish traps that's mounted right up on the back of the snowmobile. you know, it's really simple to get on there. It's just actually two of these bases. This one is fastened on, and the fish house just sits right down inside of it. Makes it real easy to throw that in there and move on to the next spot. So, you know, this whole rig here is set up so that we can get four guys and get out on the lake and efficiently go fishing. We can put three fish houses on the trailer, three guys. My gear is all on here. And we can go out, you know, got a GPS that's mounted up on the dash of the snowmobile. You know, all your electronics, you're just, you know, rigged up like any high, you know, big fancy bass boat that you'd use in the summertime. And we can go out and catch some fish.
Well, we've progressed a little bit since that we shot that piece of video. That was a couple of years ago. This is the snowmobile that's sitting outside now, or this is actually last year's. But you notice we got a fish house on the front now. These Bearcat snowmobiles come with a 2-inch receiver on the front of the snowmobile. It's an option. It's not standard equipment, but you can get that. So I got a fish house in the front, fish house in the back, the auger, the machine is plenty capable of handling, you know, two big guys riding on there. So we're amazingly efficient. If you got a long ways to go, you know, you're fishing a big body of water, or some of these lakes are back on snowmobile trails. It's kind of funny when I'm driving this rig down a snowmobile trail, though, and you meet a bunch of snowmobilers, they all pull over to the side. It's like meeting a big semi on a narrow road, because it's a big rig, but it works really well. And you can see I got my camera mounted right up here. Now I got a GPS mounted here. I got a flasher mounted on the other side, you know, so I can just sit on the seat and fish off the side of the snowmobile and move from hole to hole quickly. You know, y'all got, or I don't know, maybe y'all didn't, because there's, you know, a lot of people came, but ICE team membership. We gave away, all of them I brought with me anyway here tonight. It's a great place to get some information. The mission of ICE team is to promote and enhance the quality of ice fishing by teaching people how to use the best quality products on the market today. So there's a lot of information there. We got some webisodes on there, videos that we shot this year of catching fish that you can look them up, you know, see what's going on. The newest ones are only available to ICE team members. So I said you have an opportunity to become a member. You know, we got a forum on there. You know, the stores for in-store appearances. You know, we got guys at tournaments. So we got several on-ice events. We got a school that we're putting together over in Minnesota in March. That's, you know, I think it's almost full already, but it's actually a pretty good deal. It's, you know, basically it's a, you know, guided fishing trip for a couple of days with you know, lunch and seminars and lodging is all put into one package. You can see that at ICE team. So it's, fishing reports. I've been calling in every couple of days right now, keeping people informed of what's going on, where I'm at, and guys in different areas are doing that. There's, you know, some of the guys, you know, some more things that's available as the, you know, the videos, the articles in there. I did spend some time on the ice yesterday with a local gentleman called Tim, who's sitting back here somewhere. There he is over there. He's got all the stuff, and he's one of the local guide around here. And, you know, if you were interested in learning how to use all this stuff, he's got all that stuff. You know, you could go out there, and he'd be more than willing to show you how all this stuff works. And, you know, I'm sure you'd catch some fish besides. Also, my website, davegens.com. I've got a new book out right now called The Ice Revolution. You know, it's a kind of about how we got from the Stone Age to the Space Age, you know, how we started building these fish houses in the garage, my wife sewing them on the home sewing machine, and myself out in the garage marking a piece of conduit with a magic marker and bending it and cutting it off with a hacksaw and, you know, center punching it. But, you know, it goes through all that. And then the tricks and tips that we've learned along the way is to get here. You know, like I said, we kept asking why. Well, you know, thanks for coming and good luck on the ice. We do have a little ice safety thing yet. Maybe first I ask if you've got any questions or how are we doing on time? What time are we supposed to be out of here?
You're okay.
Okay, well, good. Anybody got any questions? Yes, sir.
Why do you put so
because I'm fishing for bigger fish. You know, yeah, I just like the way it looks on there. You'll see when you put more on there, kind of like a fan out there, and it kind of rocks in the water like that. More scent. You know, it's really important to keep that bait fresh on your hook. You know, and you know, even Mark over there, you know, he orders them by the thousand. He gets 1,000 at a time. You know, not a dozen. You know, I said you have them available here, or you can order them direct from Minnesota, and they're here in a couple days. You know, and it's a price based on volume thing. And the more you buy, the cheaper they become. Shipping gets to be the biggest issue. Yes, sir.
What's your first choice in line or leader material?
You know, I tend to use micro ice line. There's a lot of good lines out there, but micro ice is one of them. What I like about micro ice is that it's available just about everywhere you go. I like the mono though. I want a low stretch mono. If it's too stretchy, like the cold weather line that's out there, you know, you start getting the lighter line and you set the hook, it's like a big rubber band. You don't really get a decent hook set. So micro ice is my choice, low stretch mono. Somebody else had a question over here? Yes, sir. Well, I've been fishing for 4 days and I haven't kept one yet, you know. So, I've been fishing for the last 4 days in a row and I haven't kept one. So, normally I don't keep many fish. You won't find a fish in my freezer because I only eat fresh fish. And another thing, like I'm going to be gone here till the 1st of February, and there's no fish in my freezer. And my wife really likes fish, so when I get home, one of the first things she's going to say is, "Boy, I'm hungry for fish." Well, then I'll have to go. Or if they were, yes, sir.
Just a question. I noticed all the photos and the videos, you're not using tip-ups and shiners at all. Do you use tip-ups and shiners?
No. I fish with one line and fish in a lot of holes. That's, you know, and keep jigging. What kind of strange is that? When I grew up in Minnesota, we could only have one line. That's all we could have. You know, I think it was actually an advantage to me that, because it forced me to do all these things and try all these other things. Now, we're all the way up to two lines now in Minnesota, so there's still not a lot of tip-up fishing goes on in Minnesota. Yes, sir?
What's the best lake you've ever been on ice fishing?
The best lake I've ever been on ice fishing? Well, I tell you, Winnipesaukee comes really high on my list, you know, but I think it's most of the lakes are that when I had the first electronics and nobody else had any, I caught a lot of fish in them lakes. But, you know, so the best one is one they're biting on. I mean, you've got some really good lakes around here, I said, and Winnipesaukee happens to be one of the better lakes. And we got a lake in Minnesota called Winnebagoche that's similar in size, another one of my favorite lakes. But, you know, do I have a favorite lake? You know, it's wherever the favorite one is where the best rumor is. You know, so you can go there and catch fish. So one of the fish are biting in. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
Does the temperature, are you looking for a particular temperature?
If I can find 39 degrees, that's the warmest you're gonna find under the ice, because that's when water's the heaviest and sinks to the bottom, and then it stacks on top of it. You know, and so 39 degrees is the ultimate ice fishing temperature.
So does that probe measure that?
Yes, the probe on the camera does. Not the, you know, because you got to get it down to the bottom to get that temperature. Yes.
Have you ever had any experience before backsliders just using a fish finder for the ice, like pull the transducer off your boat for that in a hole?
Yeah, well, you know, I started with a green box. That's what I started with. You know, that was and I was just putting it to see if any fish came through. It didn't have enough power to see my jig. But yeah, if you've got a liquid crystal on your boat, you can definitely use that on the ice. The key factor is that you have to get it level. You can't just hang that transducer in the hole. It has to go straight down. Like a lot of times the transducer comes out of the side of the cord comes out of the side. You know, so what we had before we had the ice deucer that comes out of the top is we took a little ball and socket assembly and we took a aluminum arrow and taped the transducer to the side of that so you can move it around and get it to shoot straight down. But it will definitely help you catch more fish. Yes, sir.
How about some tips for trout
Well, when, you know, I'm using exactly the same techniques for, I'm talking about bronze or rainbows now, that I'm using the same base. I'm using the maggots, and I'm using the, you know, I'm fishing kind of the same locations, the edge of the weed beds, back in the shallow bays in the morning. And as the daytime comes on, I'm going to be out on that, on the break, end of a point I like to look for then, because it, you know, them trout tend to just kind of swim in circles during the daytime, and they'll, you know, they'll come by the end of the point, you know, got a better chance of catching them. But morning seems to be, you know, get back in them bays and fishing with maggots. Fishing with small baits, you'll catch them, you know, more trout than you will fishing with a big bait. And we're talking big trout too. Yes, sir.
Can you talk a little bit about the best fishing depth for the various species?
Well,
I know you have you find them, but
yeah, yeah. Well, the trout tend to be in the shallower water in the mornings, the browns and the rainbows. You know, Lakers tend to be, you know, much deeper. If I'm fishing for lake trout, I'm fishing a sunken island or some mid-lake feature is what I look for when I'm fishing for lake trout. And a lot of times it's tubes. I'm using a white tube is probably my most popular lake trout bait on a, you know, half to three-quarter ounce, you know, sometimes even 1 ounce. Jig, so you can get it up and down in that deep water. You know, I've had some experience up on Lake Superior on Shawamigan Bay where we're actually fishing in 200 feet of water. I hate it, but you know, there's some big fish out in that deep water, but it's not fun to fish that deep. You know, the electronics is such a big part of lake trout fishing because, you know, these fish don't, you know, we without it, you fish by the bottom. You know, but I did before I had electronics, then you drop it all the way to the bottom and you jig it on the bottom a little bit, then you take three cranks with your reel and then you jig it a little bit more and you take three more cranks with your reel and jig it a little bit more, you know, so you try to fish the water column. But it, you know, it's just so much more efficient that, you know, I can think of sitting up on Lake Simcoe a few years back and we're fishing whitefish down in the bottom in, you know, 60 feet of water, you know, and all of a sudden there's this blip on my Vexilar at 30 feet and I cranked up there as fast as I could and, you know, it about jerked the rod out of my hand. It was a nice lake trout, you know, that, and I would have had no idea that fish was there without having that Vexilar running, so. Okay, somebody else had a question. You know, I've caught some, you know, pike over 20, you know, some lake trout. I haven't caught a 20 pound lake trout. I've got them in the teens. You know what, you know, some of the things I'm probably the happiest with is I've got some, you know, 2 pound crappies and some pound and a half bluegills. That's my passion, is these are panfish. But not that I don't enjoy catching big fish once in a while, but the thing about fishing these panfish, I can catch them in the middle of the day. You know, so many times when you're fishing for these bigger fish, you end up fishing them in morning and evening. So somebody else here.
You said browns and Lakers, I mean browns and rainbows shallow in the AM?
Yes. When do I?
Where's the movement? You said they go in a big circle.
Well, they'll go up in them bays and feed in the daytime or in the morning hours, and then they'll come out to the deeper water, and they'll, you know, so if you get on the end of a point, you know, all these fish that would come here, let's say they were swimming around at 15 feet, they kind of pick a depth, and they hit that, then they come out around the end. So you get more fish if you set out here on the end that are going to come by you, just because this got in their way. They tend not to go up over the structure, they tend to go around the end of it. You know, so that's why you kind of look at the end of some sort of feature during the daytime. Okay, there was another question back there.
Those Vexilars, what frequency are those?
200, I believe, is what the kilohertz are, yes.
How long does the battery last?
You know, 2 days for sure, a weekend. You can generally go fishing, you fish a little on Friday, all day Saturday, half a day Sunday. It'll go with that without any problem. Yes, sir.
If you're covering a lot of ice, generally how much time do you spend at one spot?
So how long do I fish in a hole before I move on? You know, it's not long if I'm just searching for fish. You know, I'll come to a hole, put the Vexilar in the hole. There's nothing there. I'll get the lure on I'm fishing for the species of fish I'm fishing for, you know, drop it to the bottom, pound it into the bottom a few times, pick it up off the bottom, you know, jig it a little bit, you know, I mean, 30, 40 seconds I'm talking about jigging this thing. Then I'm going to, you know, pick it up to 3-4 feet off the bottom and jig it there a little bit and, you know, wind up and go to the next hole. You know, if I'm lake trout fishing, I might spend a little more time there because I want to be in a lot deeper water. You know, but if I'm in, you know, 20 feet of water, I'm only going to fish the, you know, the bottom 3-4 feet. I'm going to fish on the bottom, especially if I'm perch fishing, the fish are on the bottom. If I'm, you know, crappie sunfish fishing, then you want to, a lot of times they'll run, you know, 2 to 4 feet off the bottom. You know, especially if you're not, you know, being bothered by perch, if you drop down there, you're catching these perch, and you fish 2 feet off the bottom, the perch still come up and get it. You just got to fish high enough off the bottom so that the perch won't come up and get it anymore. And then you can keep your line down there. So many times when we're catching the wrong species, the perch, or the, you know, we got to figure out sometimes how not to catch them little fish. Because then we keep our line down fishing for the fish we're fishing for. And instead of every time you're winding up one of them little ones, you know, you're not spending, you know, it's taking your time. Yes, sir.
Do you like the tungsten jigs, and do you like the glow in the dark?
Yeah, red glow is my favorite color. When the red glow is the brightest, blue glow is the longest. You know, tungsten is, you know, I've been preaching since I've been doing this about small jigs that fish heavy. You know, I made several jigs over the years that were a lot heavier than most people were using. You know, not that many years ago, with a lot of people were using spoons that kind of fluttered down, because we didn't have the luxury of electronics. We were wanted to drop slow so that we were kind of fishing the entire water column. You know, so, you know, tungsten is 30% heavier than lead. You know, but, you know, if you're gonna fish small baits, then tungsten makes sense, but if you're fishing some of these larger baits, you know, some of these lead jigs still fish just fine. Yes, sir.
Well, let's go back to the Stone Age a little bit here. You know?
Okay. Well, you know, in fact, you know, droppers are a thing that works out too, or you take a, let's just use a daredevil for a word because it, you know, some kind of a spoon, but that kind of shape to it. And you tie that in your line, and then you tie your hook that you're fishing with down below it to get some flash and flutter in there. So when you're dropping it down. So you're talking about fishing lake trout, or what you're thinking about, or even panfish. Well, you know, if I, you know, don't have any electronics, but, you know, when you say you can't afford it, I mean, even the kids in here probably got some kind of Xbox or a cell phone, or, you know, the not affording electronics isn't even a fair statement anymore, because we seem to all got something that we don't really need, but we have anyway. You know, I even got an iPhone. I don't know how to use it, but I got one. But yeah, to use something that sinks slower, a slow drop. You know, before I had electronics, I was using a lot of real light lures, and I would sit there and feed them down the hole. You know, I had a fish trap already then, because I understood that when it was windy outside, I couldn't fish these light lures. You had to get inside to get out of the wind so you could let these lures, you know, flutter down. You could kind of keep track of your line in there. And it was kind of funny, the fish traps were all white back then because I needed to see in there. You know, now with the electronics, I can see if my jig is going down because it's going around the dial. But yeah, with you know, to use a fluttering spoon if you're not using electronics is not a bad idea. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
Does your fishing strategy change on the time of year, early or late ice, mid ice?
Well, yeah, it's you know, early ice, we generally start out pretty shallow again. And, you know, it's kind of the same thing that happens in the summertime. When we get first ice, the fish are a lot active in there, and they're shallow. Late ice, stick around for a little bit. Yep, we're going to give some prizes away you might have won. Then as the season progresses, we need to fish more mid-lake features because the oxygen levels in the weed beds, the weeds die off. And they're, you know, you need to get out in the lake more. Then late season is as soon as the water goes through the ice. When the snow all melts and all of a sudden the water goes through, and then the fish move back shallow again. Okay, should we give them that stuff away here, Mark?
Absolutely. First off, thank you, Dave.
All right, thank you.